Hi everyone, my name is Ali Sharif, and my talk is entitled Creating a Better Developer Experience. Just a short introduction of what I do. I work at a company called 25th Floor here in Vienna, and what we do is mainly build large-scale business applications. So most of the time I work as a software engineer, and we mainly use methodologies like Scrum to kickstart our projects and to manage our projects. So we have a very deep expertise in Agile and everything around that revolves around Agile. And a deep expertise in Agile product development, and we do consulting for a number of companies, including enterprises, and workshops, and things of that nature. Now, why did I choose this topic, creating a better developer experience? Let's get one thing out of the way. I'm not going to speak about the experience of building a cool API. This is what most people think about when they hear the word developer experience, or how to use the IDE to make you more effective. My idea is that I'm currently trying to write a book, a free ebook, where I'm trying to go deep into the idea of team culture, how the teams functions, and I've been speaking to a lot of people, including a lot of engineers, CEOs, project managers, product owners, different people in agencies or enterprises, and what I've really found out is there's a very high frustration level sometimes. So there's a huge gap between what we hear in theory and what the reality is as a developer. So the baseline or the bottom line of this whole talk will be, and this is very simple in theory, is that motivated developers create better products. And you can interchange the word products with projects or apps or prototypes. So this is our basic assumption, right? This is what we assume is that we want motivated developers. And the theory is well known. So I won't go too deep about what Agile is or what Scrum is. Those methodologies are well known, the books about it, and there are a large number of ideas out there in theory. So we know about Scrum, and now the Holacracy, the new big thing, and Lightning Holacracy, and so on and so forth, and Kanban. So I think most people know or heard about those basic ideas. But the thing is that, and this is what we tend to do in IT, is we find a solution, like Framework X, and then we start applying Framework X to every problem. Because we have this idea that we're looking for a silver bullet. And the thing is, there is no silver bullet. And we have to accept that, right? There is no silver bullet. This is something that we should, and we should have learned better. The past has shown us that when Framework X came, we thought, okay, I'm gonna throw Framework X on any problem I have. And Framework X then suddenly was outdated or couldn't solve those problems. And this is very similar to all the methodologies in project management in IT. Because one thing that we neglect is company culture, right? And this plays a huge role. What about the culture, right? You can't just take a solution that worked for company X and then think company Y will be successful with it. These things mostly don't work. And when we go through the or show through the internet, we'll find thousands of blog posts bashing on Scrum, for example, because people really very often have a very bad experience with Scrum, right? So, and I was thinking, like, what can we do to make things maybe more, create a better experience for developers, right? And there's somebody I really respect called Martin Fowler. He's very well known. He's written books about enterprise development and Agile and things of that nature. And he says, and this is from a blog post called Agile in Position, he says that imposing a process on the team is completely opposed to the principle of Agile software and has been since its inception. So what he says now is that a manager or somebody higher up decides how the team should organize It goes against the Agile. I found this tweet and I tweeted it a couple of weeks ago, also from Martin Fowler, from the same blog post. And he says that not just should a team choose their own process, the team should be control of how that process evolves, right? And this is from the same blog post. And this blog post was from the year 2006. So now it's almost 10 years ago. And we still have the same problem, right? So what he decides on methodology, and it's mostly people who have never really been developers themselves. This is the funny thing about it. When you speak to a lot of consultants, they've never been developers themselves, right? But they come in there and tell people and tell experts or knowledge workers how to do their work, and this is funny. And my mission this year or next year will be to give people the simple idea. I'm just gonna give you the most pragmatic approach that you could change things in your site environment. There's another person I really respect. This is DHH, David Heinemeier Hansen, who wrote Ruby on Rails, and he said, if you want to have an impact, you prepare to say the same thing for a decade. So what I'm going to do today is, I'm not going to tell you the magic formula. There is no magic formula. This talk or session will just be a reminder of those simple things we know, and these are things that might be a quarter century old, right? But the funny thing is, it's so obvious, when we talk to people, the people don't apply these things, and this is funny. So my mission today is that I just told you a couple of ideas. I throw those ideas against the crowd, and I hope I might get some feedback later on, maybe afterwards, and ideas that might trigger new ideas. So let's just start with my first thing I want to throw in there. This is the daily. Who knows the daily? Who's heard of the daily? Okay. Who does Scrum? Okay, but if you know Scrum, you should know the daily, right? Okay. A lot of people hate that daily, right? Who hates the daily? Nobody? Okay, let's be honest. Thomas Schwanz wrote a blog post called The Daily Stand-Up. Feels like an interrogation, right? The thing is that mostly when you do it by the book, the daily is quite, has sometimes a quite negative impact on people because it quickly turns into a status report meeting. The idea, the basic idea of a daily is something totally different, actually. The idea of the daily is, in its most basic form, is to communicate on a daily basis. And it's those, say, 15 minutes where the team really syncs up. So you synchronize the whole team by doing an effective meeting format where people just stand around or sit or whatever, and they just synchronize what they're gonna do today. And the thing is, we've been doing dailies for years now, and to be very honest, we weren't very successful with it. The thing is that there are these rules where people have to stand and you have to answer those questions, and people get frustrated because it really turns into a status meeting. So I'm gonna ask again, who likes that daily? Nobody likes that daily. Okay, that was the question I wanted to know. So, the thing is, you can change these things. What we learned is at some point we said, forget it. This daily has a lot of worth because this idea that we can get on a daily basis is powerful, actually. It gives you the opportunity to find out what my colleagues are doing and to get insights. And what we did then, we said, let's just throw everything we know on the daily. We will not answer those three questions. Everybody just gets like 30 to 1 minute to speak on what he's going to do today, what his impediment is, but it's going to be an invitation format. Nobody's supposed to come to this daily. If you don't want to come, don't come. And what happened is, when we changed from very formal to very informal, the daily started to make sense, and we got really successful with it. So after doing it for years, trying to solve the same problem, we said, let's throw out everything. And let's just say anything goes, right? Anything goes for us as a team. So if one thing doesn't work, just because somebody's saying you have to do it like this, doesn't mean you have to do it like this. This is really important. And what most people do is they start hating the daily. So instead of hating the daily, what you can do is you can change that name. For example, call it whatever. Call it a morning meetup or a coffee machine talk or whatever you want. Yeah? Just try to take the time to really synchronize with your colleagues for 15 minutes a day, because the underlying idea is powerful. But there's only one rule we kept in there, was the time box effect, right? Because 15 minutes, this is all that goes actually. Now imagine this would take a half hour. The first person that spoke would have to wait, would fall asleep until the last guy would speak. So this is the only thing I would say is keep a time box, keep it effective, and this will work. And it should be 10 of us. So I think we should give the idea up that everybody is forced to join every meeting. I think this is really the killer number one, right? People want to do it with free will. And if it's really done well, people will come and join. This will always work. And what we always do is we also start experimenting with our daily format. So we change it sometimes, we change the time. Sometimes we do it at 10 in the morning, but maybe we decide the next spring we're going to do it at 12. So we just really play around with it and achieve a lot more success and had a much better team culture due to that daily, actually. Okay. I'm going to stay in this Scrum context, and maybe another meeting format you should really introduce. The retrospective. Who knows about the retrospective? Who does one in his company? Okay, not that many, right? You know what happens? When they say we're going to introduce Scrum into our company, the first meeting they kill off is that retrospective. Why do they do that? Because the manager will say, there's no business value when we do a retrospective. Where's that business value? People are just speaking left and right. We don't care. From my point of view, this is the most important meeting. And it doesn't matter if you're doing agile or Scrum or traditional software development or traditional project management or in an agency setup. This meeting format is super powerful because it gives you the opportunity to define a certain date, and it has to be frequently. It has to be recurring, right? And you could say, like, we could do this once every Friday or every 2 weeks. But what we do at 25th Floor, for example, and this is already because of the Scrum framework, we do it at the end of every sprint. So after a review, we have this idea of self-reflection as a team. And if you're in a different setting, you could just say, I'm going to do it every 1 or 2 weeks, for example. But it should be a recurring event. It should be an event where people have the opportunity to really vent their anger or frustration, for example. And it should be an environment where, and this is really important, so that it really, really works. You have to enable that environment where people can speak openly. So now imagine in your team you might have conflicts, you might be hating that guy next to you because he's really going on your nerves. And this is where the meeting, where things happen. This is where you can really say, this and this now is really hindering me to be productive, for example. And where you can just really create an environment where people start to open up and really focus on the idea that we talk about individuals here, right? It's about people. And these people inside my team have personal life, have personal problems, have personal aspirations. So there's just more than just software development. It's a lot more behind the idea than just somebody writing code, right? What I also think is very powerful, and a lot of people have a hard time with it, is just giving honest feedback. Because sometimes you have the feeling you're hurting somebody's feelings, or you're crossing a line. I mean, these ideas are really so basic. But when I talk to people, most people say we don't have this type of meeting format. So when they're angry, they stay angry. They don't know who to go to, they can't really vent their anger. There's no channel to really focus on those underlying problems, right? And actually, there's only one rule, and it should be non-offensive. And so, if you can stick to the idea that if I'm really fed up with somebody because he keeps breaking that bill, then I won't say you broke that bill. You'd rather say like something like, "What can we do to improve or prevent from our bill from breaking?" Right? We need to find that language, that context, that communication that really works. So in a Scrum context, they say that at the end of a retrospective, you have to reflect on what happened really well at our last sprint, and what can we do to improve. So it's always a positive aspect to it, it's improve. It's not what went bad, it's what we can improve. And I think this is a really important part, right? We want to move on from this typical, it's his or her fault situation, which we always have in IT. Somebody gets blamed, and then somebody has to blame somebody else, and it just leads to a lot of frustration. and destroys team culture. So one last thing is that there are no real rules, like I said already. You have to find your own way to do that meeting. You can call it wherever you want to, but I would advise everybody, honestly, try to find that one meeting, maybe it's 1 hour or 1.5 hours, once a week or every 2 weeks, and really just reflect on what's happening, right? Try to find out why somebody, for example, couldn't deliver what he promised to deliver. This is the way you can find out. So this one's really, really high on my list. Okay, so we just talked about two media formats. Now let's talk about something that I find is really, really negative. And this is the blame game. Who knows about the blame game? Two people? Okay. If you don't know what the blame game is, it's this situation. If you're still playing who wrote the build game or stuck in a who wrote the scrap type of culture, then stop. Please stop. It's about blaming your build developers when something goes wrong with the application, for example. It's like finding out who wrote this piece of code and why did he write it and he broke it and that's his fault. And I think this is really, really negative. What happens when you start playing that blame game? It has a lot of effects to it. One thing that is really, really, what really becomes obvious is that there's a lack of trust inside your team. Once you start playing that blame game, it means somebody has code ownership and he might be blamed for messing up. And what we want trust, what we want to achieve is trust. Because if there's no trust, you become very defensive. You know? What you're going to do now is you're going to stop learning. Why do you stop learning here? Because if you know that you'll get that you will be blamed for something, what will you do? You will start to be very defensive and just do the things you know that will work. So you won't start experimenting with a new paradigm or trying out a new framework or learning new things, because new things means you might fail with it, right? So what happens is you hinder your own progress. And then the thing is that maybe your colleagues in company Z, they will start surpassing you because they will start to dig deeper, experiment with stuff, and have this mentality of, it doesn't matter if you fail, fail and just move on, right? And with the blame game is now people get defensive because nobody wants to get blamed, right? So you're gonna start doing things you know will work. And you're caught up in this comfort zone suddenly. And it starts destroying your team culture because once everybody can be blamed for everything, people will start moving away from each other. So this is really, really negative. But then, to be honest, who's heard of extreme programming? Okay. I mean, extreme programming was created by Ken Beck in 1996. So this is about 20 years old. And what I'm going to say now here is that this is stuff that has been really proven over time, and still people don't use those approaches, right? Pair programming. Who has heard of pair programming? Who does pair programming? Okay, a lot less people. The thing with pair programming is when you tell somebody, let's do pair programming, is for people who don't know what pair programming is, it's just two programmers, one computer, and they just switch roles, right? So you have the driver who's on the keyboard and the navigator who's sitting next, and then you switch positions, right? Which is a very strong approach. Why? Because it's now two brains working. There's a much higher level of efficiency in here. And what we hear in reality is what managers say is, wow, so now I've got to pay two